So my topic is the biological basis of conscious experiences.
Processes, but it's the conscious one.
ones that will kill them. Because it's the conscious ones that are limited in capacity and therefore make them vulnerable. And that is the limited capacity paradox in its most, in its raw as biological fashion. So, with that kind of limited capacity, how did you and I ever get here? It's very likely, if it's a dysfunctional adaptation, it's very likely that we would never have gotten here. We're talking about 200 million years of mammalian evolution, where we know that the capacity of conscious contents is a very important issue. And so the question is, how do we ever get here? And my answer at the bottom of this page is, we wouldn't have gotten here. Limit capacity is so narrow, even though we have a huge brain with vast numbers, about 90 billion neurons, with trillions of synapses between the neurons, and with huge memory capacity, that probably includes vast number of memories that reflect our conscious experiences. All those capacities are enormous, and there are many other large capacities, but they are unconscious. The conscious problem is the limited capacity. How do you and I ever get here? Well, I don't think we would have. And so our faithful dogs would have been mourning our the soldier here in Harvard who has died one way or another. So the question is, how could this be biologically adaptive? Well, this question suggests that conscious cognition provides compensatory benefits. And there are many, many adaptations. Indeed, all biological adaptations arguably have pros and cons. So that if there are drawbacks, for example, we do not have large weapons built into our bodies like the lion does, or like the snake does, or the dog for that matter. And we live on the basis of our inventions and our capacity to think and discover tools and work socially with others in hunting groups and domesticating dogs and many other, many, many other adaptations that humans have built, which are mainly dependent upon our cultural capabilities, which are in turn dependent upon the brain. Like any other biological capacity, conscious and unconscious events have pros and cons. And in this particular case, you see primate skulls, which are different in size, and the one on the right is the human one, if I'm correct about that. And as you can see, and as you know, of course, having a large brain by itself has pros and cons, such as the size of the birth canal in human females who need to give birth to babies with large heads, which is a major drawback biologically. It exacts a high cost, and women still pay that cost when they give birth. What's the compensatory advantage that consciousness provides? Well, the claim that I have made and that my colleagues have made is that consciousness cognition creates many kinds of access. Access is not just one thing. They claim here from a 1997 article in the Journal of Consciousness Studies is that a number of different functions have access to each other by way of conscious experience, one way or another. And we'll mention a few ways in which that can happen. So, for example, one of the most important aspects of this is that there is access between the what is traditionally known as the observing self or the observing eye, which is the input side, in a sense, of executive functions to the brain. are traditionally called ego functions, and I think we ought to go back to the word ego functions, because the word ego means I in Latin. And we are particularly talking here about what William James called the observing self, as opposed to the self as the object of cognition and perception. We can think about ourselves, but that's not the same thing as being ourselves. And I follow Immanuel Kant, actually, in suggesting that consciousness involves a interaction between the observing self and the objects of perception. So you don't have consciousness without both of those ingredients. It's a joint function of a observable self system, observing self system, and the contents of consciousness and the potential consciousness of consciousness. Other access, there's an access between implicit goals, which are now known, which are now verified by experimental tests. Great experimental literature has arisen on implicit goals and voluntary actions, so that we know that our implicit goals, which may be denied or which may be simply unknown to us, implicit goals do shape voluntary actions, the actions that are subjectively voluntary and which are controlled by the executive functions of the prefrontal cortex in human beings. So that's another way in which access is created. I believe, and my colleagues like Stan Franklin believe, the conscious experiences. And finally, consciousness creates access between sensory and learning, which is a hugely important connection that I'll get back to later. Next slide, please. The final example I want to give about specifics is from an article by Stan Franklin and myself in 2003 in Trends in Cognitive Sciences, namely that conscious elements can recruit unconscious working memory functions. Now, we know by now that working memory is not a box in the brain, that working memory recruits all kinds of distributed functions in the cortex, including the linguistic areas of cortex, both on the right side and left side, the left side typically being the production side, and the right side being largely receptive. Nevertheless, they work together, of course, if you have an intact corpus callosum, which allows for very fast and very wide bandwidth connection between the two hemispheres, interaction between the hemispheres. In normal people, the two hemispheres work together. But the linguistic component, as you know, especially the production side, resides mostly on the left-hand side in most people. The argument that Stan and I made in 2003 is that the global workspace of consciousness enables and triggers unconscious functions like the language functions. On the left-hand side of the bottom, here we see unconscious verbal automatisms. Obviously, working memory, unconscious items in working memory. Once we are conscious of the item in for working memory, it goes into an unconscious state for about 10 to 30 seconds, and we can retrieve it and bring it back to consciousness. And of course, we have unconscious visual spatial mechanisms in traditional working memory. We call it called various things, the visual spatial component of working memory is one of the things it's traditionally called. Next slide, please. I'm on slide 12 now. Here's a useful metaphor, but it's only a metaphor. Remember that metaphors are not theories, but they are useful. Historically, in science, we've used a lot of metaphors. In this particular case, we have the lady singing in the light, who was singing a song, and that make it possible for the lady to be singing in the light and for the spotlight to be pointed at her at the appropriate times, and for the other actors to come on stage and for the play to work out. All those details have been worked out in the past under the control of the director, who's sort of an executive function, and any number of other people who are invisible to the audience. And it's worth remarking that the audience itself is also unconscious, of course. So we have broadcasting all of the information in the bright light on stage, and that is spread to the unconscious audience of multiple specialized processors, and as well as being spread to the backstage stagehands, directors, spotlight operators, and whatever else you have. Again, it's a useful metaphor for thinking about it, and it's also a metaphor. Slide 13, please. Now, in the brain, we have the anatomical basis of conscious content, which has, for more than a century, been believed to involve the cortex in close interaction with the thalamus. The corticothalamic system is one way of talking about it, or the thalamocortical system. There are people who argue for one or the other. Those two structures, the thalamus cortex, are interleaved with incredible density, and every region of cortex has its corresponding thalamic nucleus. But the word nucleus is quite misleading, because these nuclei are really layered structures. They're not nuts. That's what the original meaning of nucleus is, a nut that is round and is compact and so on. And that is indeed how it looks with the naked eye, but under the microscope, the histology emerges as the same cellular structure. It emerges very beautifully, as we've known for 100 years, and so then we can look at the layered structure, both of thalamic nuclei and also of the corresponding pieces of the cortex. So we talk about the corticothalamic system, or the thalamocortical system, as being the basis of conscious contents. I want to emphasize contents here, because vision and voluntary control, cognition, and so on are reflected in cortex and the corresponding thalamic nuclei as well. And also, that is not the control system for the states of consciousness. The states of consciousness, as you know, are controlled by small nuclei in the base of the brain. Some of them are the brain stem, some of them are a little bit outside of the brain stem, but in any case, they are basal brain neuromodulating nuclei, and they protect, they spritz neuromodulators to various parts of the brain, sometimes very quickly, more commonly, as we think about it, to turn on and off the state of sleep, waking, dreaming. And on the left hand side, below there, you see the awake EEG trace. On the right hand side, you see the REM EEG trace, which looks identical to the waking thing in the case, because they're both conscious states. And right in the middle, you see non REM sleep. The technical example being, or the strongest example at least, being deep sleep. And in deep sleep, we see those long delta waves, which involve simultaneous buzzing and pausing of billions of neurons, so that when they simultaneously buzz, the delta wave sweeps upward, and when they simultaneously pause, the delta wave sweeps downward in trough, so that during the down cycle of the delta wave, processing is blocked in the corticothalamic system, and during the up wave, it is permitted. And a beautiful work by Masagini and slide number 14. And this is a beautiful illustration of the critical economic system. And as you can see quite nicely here, in this particular case, we're looking at projections that look like they're coming from somewhere deep in the critical economic system and projecting upward. The critical economic system, of course, the cells of the cortex are sitting on the outside. They're just about a millimeter or two or three thick in terms of the actual cellular layers, and the rest is white matter and axons with myelination around it that fill a huge amount of the volume of our very large brains. And these colored axons that you see here should really be white, but they are shown in color just to indicate the different tracts of the cortical thalamic system, hugely interconnected system, which is what differentiates it from other parts of the brain. And this is from a very nice biologically faithful simulation by Ishikiewicz and Edelman, published in PNAS in 2008. Slide number 15, please. Brains are massively parallel I/O computers, or societies of I/O computers. And we now know that the waves that have been observed since 1929, since the invention of the EEG by Hans Berger, that those waves are functional. That's another story, and I can't prove that right here, but it is now generally believed, and of course there are people at this conference, like Paul Singer, for example, who were onto that way back then, just like there are people at this conference who have done many, many important things. We have some wonderful scientists at this conference, so I'm grateful to have them. So this is a very cool image emerging out of this, the red dots in this simulation of the brain based on biologically faithful neurons, and simulation of the cortical thalamic system, I should say. The red dots are excitatory neurons, the black dots, which are a little hard to see, are inhibitory neurons. You put them all together, you get these convergent waveforms at the mesoscopic or macroscopic level of the brain, which is quite stunning. And you can download a little video from this article, and I would highly recommend just playing that little video and looking at it and watching the surf waves emerge from a simulation that's been programmed only at the level of single neurons or interaction between neurons as well, of course. So this is an extraordinary piece of simulation, I think. So what we have here is a hypothesis that the conscious objects of experiences are associated with momentary broadcasts in the brain medium of the TC core. And the notion that this is the wave medium was verified by animal neurophysiologists, people like Virginia Styriot, who has a wonderful article in 2006 that discusses this and that proposes indeed that the cortical thalamic system should be considered to be a coherent wave medium. And that's not the only kind of code that the cortical thalamic system uses, but it's a major source of coding schemes. Now, we know from a variety of wonderful studies using trigonography, but also from traditional anatomical studies, that the cortical thalamic system has many, many different hubs and many, many different highways. And the actual work on that has been done recently by Char, by a number of other people, indicating that small world mathematics applied to the cortical thalamic system exists to some within certain scales. And 18, please. And here is a nice way of showing it. You can see the orientation of the head here to pointing to the left. This is the extent of my drawing capability. If anybody can do a better job, please do so and let me know about it. There are a number of different hypotheses of different parts of the cortex performing as hubs or at least as components of consciousness. I'm going to talk about four of them. On the left-hand side, we have the cortex, but in particular, we have the prefrontal cortex. A little bit on the top right-hand side, we have area V1, the first visual area of the cortical stream of visual regions. On the one notch below that, we have area IT in humans, which is the bottom of the temporal lobe, the inferotemporal cortex, and therefore area IT, which is known to be involved in object representation. And on the very bottom, we have a very controversial part of the hypothesis, which is whether MTL, the medial temporal lobe and hippocampus, may also be involved in conscious contents. We have people who have made specific proposals, in particular, Alan Schlosser. This is slide 19, I should say, slide 19. Alan Schlosser had proposed that the prefrontal cortex is involved, is the global workspace for the brain, and there's been evidence for that, but particularly for feelings of effort in the early work from Alan Schlosser. Zeki and Lamy have argued that early visual cortex is the basis of at least visual cortex and visual consciousness. Lopez Zeki and all have provided very beautiful evidence based on Bradbury and the fact that area IT, infratemporal cortex in humans, is the place where it all comes together, basically, so that 90% of the neurons respond to the conscious input, but not to the matched unconscious input. This is where we love these, where this area is called TE rather than IT, but I'm going to call it IT. And then nobody, well, it's not quite true. Some people have proposed that MTL and hippocampus might also support conscious contents. And the reason for skepticism on that today is that HM had normal seeming consciousness, and HM, of course, did not have hippocampi. He's the famous surgical patient from 19-something, I think, when he had his bilateral excision of the medial temporal lobe, which includes the two hippocampi and amygdalas as well, so that this is taken to be strong evidence that the hippocampi are at least not necessary for consciousness. But in any case, I believe that it could participate in consciousness in healthy people who do have an intact MTL, and I will talk about that a little bit later. Next slide is number 20, and this is a prediction from Global Workspace Dynamics, which is that conscious contents can emerge anywhere in the CT core, depending upon stimulus and task conditions. So I think that the Hanna-Schoenscher were right about the prefrontal cortex, but only for certain kinds of contents, conscious contents. Zeki, I believe, was right about V3, V4. Lame is right about early visual cortex. He's an author right about visual objects, and I believe that there are one or two people who have argued that MTL and the hippocampus, and I think that that involves episodes, conscious episodes. So, the argument here is that any of these four regions can both very live question right now, and I believe Bjorn Berger will make that case at this conference. So the claim here is, on slide 22, that the prefrontal cortex gives us feelings of knowing, which are very, very important. As William James pointed out in 1890, he called them fringe conscious experiences. And the most famous example is the tip of the tongue experience. I also would suggest that early visual cortex is just right for perceiving a single bright star on a dark night, that is to say, a single bright point in a dark, lightless surround, because V1 has a high resolution visual maps that are perfect for that. It can distinguish between dark and light. It does not do higher level analysis, although it can participate in higher level analysis from higher visual optical maps of the visual system. When we want to see a coffee cup on a table within body space, we use IT, and indeed we also use the dorsal stream, which is not shown here, but the dorsal stream and the ventral stream interact with each other in order to be able to see visual objects. And it's been argued by Shimomura that indeed those two, the dorsal and ventral stream, join in the MTL, and that's an interesting hypothesis, and it certainly fits the global worst-case orientation that I've developed since 1980, roughly. So the conscious episodes, whole episodes, sequence, causality, interactions, perhaps, between human beings, but relatively short event scenarios, which are conscious, are encoded, I would suggest, in the MTL, IT, as well, and even new regions that are newly discovered to have a role in these kinds of things, such as the lateral occipital cortex. There are always multiple visual topical maps that work together, by the way, so that I don't mean to say that if there's a starburst sign in IT, for example, I don't mean to rule out the participation of the other areas, but this kind of a center of gravity of activity occurs in IT. Here's a very pretty study. This slide from Sam Duisberg and colleagues, including Lawrence Ward, called Large Scale M-Event Phase Synchronization and Selective Tension in Cerebral Cortex a few years ago. I actually don't have the 2007, yes. A very, very good study, asking people to attend to an LED on the left side of visual space, and then to attend to an LED, flashing LED, probably, on the right-hand side of visual space. And as we know, there's contralateral projections or contralateral streaming of the signal that happens in such cases when we look at the lateral halves of each hemifield or hemiretina. We're looking at the left visual cue. This crosses, the left side crosses over to the right hand side. The right side stays on the right hand side. They jointly activate the area V1 and upward of the visual vertex, so that the right hemisphere, in this particular case, is the first one to pick up the visual stimulus. And Duisberg et al. Found that you get this beautiful burst of activity emerging from the right hemisphere visual vertex. However, it goes right across the corpus callosum because there's two kind of billion fibers there, or So at time t equals 800 milliseconds, you get a broadcast burst, basically, from the right-hand visual cortex. And by that time, it may already have gotten to IT and even to MTL. I'm not quite sure about that. There's also another extraordinary study, very sophisticated study. And this is number 26, slide number 26. Extraordinary study by Ayar Khan and colleagues in Cluster 1 in 2009. Beautiful study using Ranger analysis to pull out causal relationships in the time series. And this shows what Dahal calls the ignition, which I would call the global broadcast, although it's not really necessarily right now based on the evidence that we can tell the difference between the binding component of the global workspace and the broadcast component of the global workspace. And this one shows a number of different events, signaling events. The dark colors are the increases, and also decreases, by the way, because we have information processing going on. It's not all increases of activation, because that would be not functional. In order to do this functionally, you have to identify the stimulus, and some levels of the stimulus become emphasized, and others become inhibited. So in this particular case, Ayar and company found gamma coherence increase for conscious versus unconscious stimuli broadcasting from the occipital to the temporal, parietal, and I should add frontal regions. Now, there's a little bit of frontal stuff going on. There usually is. It depends upon the amount of time. And here's another beautiful series of experiments by Antti Levonsuo in Finland and his several former students who are now running their own studies using the ventilated potential. And Antti and his co-workers have discovered what they call visual awareness negativity, the VAN, about almost 300 milliseconds after the onset of the stimulus. It is considered to be roughly a component of the P3P wave, the P3P wave, which has a particular meaning that you just looked out. And then there is also a P component, the positive difference, which occurs between 400 and 500 milliseconds post stimulus. What is interesting about these waveforms is that they occur only in the conscious case and not in the comparison case that is unconscious. So we know that it is linked to consciousness, and this kind of result has been replicated now maybe a dozen times. And so it's a good solid result. And since it's coming from visual cortex, I would argue that it's probably a simple stimuli. We're expecting this to involve early visual cortex, and which is roughly what we see here in terms of the activity wave that is moving forward. So here's the hypothesis again. This is global workspace dynamics as of today in 2012. And the prediction is that conscious contents can emerge anywhere in the cortical fund or depending upon stimulus and task conditions, including the prefrontal cortex, for feelings of knowing, tip of the tongue, a sense of effort, and many other things which are very, very important, by the way. And for example, the sense of mental effort is strongly associated with the G component of the intelligence test. I'm also claiming that MTL and hippocampus are involved in consciousness in people with intact brains, but that in the case of NHM, what we got was a replacement function. wonderful subject. It's been studied many, many times in very careful ways over a 50-year period or longer. And we recently died in HM in slide 28. Could still have spirit consciousness because most of his neocortex, almost all his neocortex, was spirit. So he still had the capacity for conscious competence in these other regions of brain. If he had been very carefully studied with precisely the right questions, it's possible that he might have been shown to have problems with event boundaries, for example. But you can only study what you can study at a time, and then later on you may find out different things. And finally, the last slide, number 29, the details on this theoretical work can be found in the 1988 book from Cambridge University Press, which is now on Amazon Kindle because I want to make it available to as many people as possible. For $10, you can get the original Cognitive Theory of Consciousness, which lays out all the hypotheses, has the philosophy that still applies. The one thing that's lacking in that book most conspicuously is the brain evidence, because we didn't have the brain evidence in 1988. So that is laid out in the greatest amount of detail with the largest number of references in my second textbook. The first one was more advanced. This one is more fundamental with Nicole Gage, R.C. Gage, Fundamentals of Cognitive Neuroscience, Beginner's Guide. And I would particularly call your attention to Chapter 8, the chapter on consciousness and attention, which provides a huge amount of evidence for the framework that I'm discussing here. So thank you very much for your attention. I'm delighted to be here, if only via computer and web. But I think that Steve and his colleagues have done an extraordinary job. This is extremely high level competence, and obviously the ASSC is being simultaneously in Brighton in the UK, which is another wonderful event. We have made great progress in both apparently and in communicating with each other in the last 2 years, 30 years, I guess. So I congratulate you all on that, and the students who are here are lucky to be getting the best people in the world to talk to and to hear from. So thank you all for your attention, and I have many people to thank for, more people than I can mention here. I hope to have that opportunity perhaps to do a lot of conference. Thank you.
Just give me a second.